right, we're back again, and this time we're going to continue with this whole idea of looking for antecedents for why the Muslims are doing what they're doing, and finding that the reason they're doing what they're doing is because they've just barred from the Jews. They've just barred from previous practices. In this case, we're going to look now at the two hills, Safa and Marwa. And so I'm going to bring it right back on to Mel. Mel, here you are again. Thanks for coming on board, giving us another bit of your time. What can you tell us about Safa and Marwa, and what is the significance of these two mountains from a Judaic standpoint? And then how did the Muslims get something that was very important actually confused? Over to you.
Okay, well, actually, I have to say I chuckled when you said that Safa and Marwa were hills, but that's beside the point. Little boulders, should we say, in Mecca. But the significance in the Jewish tradition originally is this is the location of the apocalypse. So if you remember back to the last episode, we heard about the threshing floor where the wheat and the chaff were separated. Well, this was believed by Jews to be the place where the apocalypse would happen, when the Messiah would come, and even for Christians as well, Jesus would return. This is where Jesus prayed across the hill in the Garden of Gethsemane, so it's hugely significant. And that valley in between is the valley of the apocalypse. So obviously the significance originally was that by walking back and forth, you were entering the very site of the apocalypse. And obviously there's that creates a kind of a lot of eschatological expectations about the end times. So it's obviously hugely significant.
In big words, not everybody will know what you mean by apocalypse or eschatological. Can you define those two?
Well, I suppose we'll start with eschatological. It's simply a big word for the understanding of what will happen in the end days in terms of, the apocalypse is essentially another word for that. From my understanding, there may be a finer meaning, but that's how I understand it.
It's also understood. So let me the destruction, the last destruction.
Yeah. So let me just bring up my PowerPoint here. Right. So essentially, today we're looking at Safa and Marwa, and this is another reason why we believe that the original Masjid Al Haram is on the Temple Mount and not in Mecca. So what about Safa and Marwa? Well, here's an image from Mecca. We see Marwa there on the top and then Safa, and Muslims today go back and forth between these two places. But what's interesting is that neither of these places have any history prior to the 8th century and no biblical support for their location there. So that's quite surprising, to say the least. And we look at the actual hills. Okay, so as you can see from the pictures there, these are not hills. These are just mere rocks, maybe a tiny location that even a child could climb. So these are not hills. They may be slightly disguised because they're hidden under a building. But also, if you think about it, you're not really going down into a valley and back up again. You're literally walking on a flat ground between both locations. It's essentially like walking through an airport with air conditioning and protection from the sun. It couldn't be more pleasant. This is a far cry from the original idea of going on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. Now, if we look at Jerusalem itself, we see that these places were originally there in Jerusalem. So we can see, obviously, Mount of Olives, which is where Jesus prayed. But over here is Mount Moriah, or Marwa, as it's pronounced in Arabic. Over here, we see Mount Scopus. And we know that this was called Safa as long ago as 2,000 years ago, because Josephus says that. And there in the middle is the Kedron Valley, the Valley of Decision. This is the place where the apocalypse was meant to happen. So you can imagine that when Muslims invaded and took over Jerusalem, they would have started doing hajjs, imitating the Jews, and they would have originally walked between these two hills because they were full of apocalyptic expectations that the world was soon to end, and they wanted to be in the most important place on earth, which was the site of the apocalypse. Yep. So okay. There was a note from Paul Ellis on this. He mentioned that the Quran doesn't mention Jehoshaphat, which is there, the Kedron Valley, but it does mention Jehannam. 77 times and 101 times if you include the word Jaheen. Now, where is that? Well, let me just bring up another map so you can see. There is the Kedron Valley. There is Henan, or Jahannam. And it's interesting that the Quran mentions that 101 times, and yet Mecca is only mentioned once. So that would really emphasize for me that this is where it was all at. This was the most important place originally, when the people who wrote the Quran were writing these words. They're obviously considering the Temple Mount to be this significant place. Now, if we look at Islamic traditions, we actually see support for the Jerusalem thesis. You can see the names of these. I'm not going to read out the names of these, okay? But let's take some examples. The Rock of Jerusalem is one of the rocks of paradise. We find in the Torah that God said to the Rock of Jerusalem, "You are my lowest throne, and from you I ascended into heaven. And below you the earth is extended, and all the water that flows from the tops of the mountains comes from below you." Now, what's interesting here, and this is a mistake I would suggest, if God is saying, "I ascended into heaven," well, who are they referring to as ascending into heaven? Is that Jesus? And it's somehow got lost in the tradition there, but that's a little aside. We also see here, it says, "Jerusalem is the land which Allah has chosen from among the other lands." So clearly, it's a very important location, chosen before all others. And it's the place where God will destroy Gog and Magog. So it's obviously a place for the apocalypse. It also says the gathering and the resurrection of the dead will take place in Jerusalem. Okay. So do you remember we spoke about the threshing floor? And this is the place where the good and the bad would be judged. So this gathering of the living and the dead would happen there. This is according to the Islamic tradition. So where did they get that from? From the Temple Mount. That's the argument. And I think that's a strong argument. Now, if we look at a picture of where we're talking about, there's Marwa, or Mount Moriah. And here is Mount Scopus, or Safa. So let's have a look at the significance of this location again. It's where God will destroy Gog and Magog. God will judge the living and the dead. The Messiah would return here and enter the Eastern Gate, which is it's actually just along that wall there at the top of the hill, which incidentally, the Ottomans put a graveyard there to block the Messiah from entering the Eastern Gate because they believed it would contaminate him. And, you know, it's a very strange thing that they've blocked the Messiah in their minds from entering the Eastern Gate. And they have also this idea that Isa, which is their idea of Jesus, would destroy Al-Masih ad-Dajjal in a place near Tel Aviv, Lud near Tel Aviv. So all of their apocalyptic ideas circulate around places like Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. So this would indicate that this is really where they borrowed all their ideas, which eventually showed up in Mecca at a later point. And so essentially the apocalypse would happen here. That's what the Islamic tradition is suggesting.
So here, once again, it looks like as you're piecing it together and what you're doing, you're pulling out so many of the things out of the, not just the Quran, but you're also looking at the traditions and looking and trying to understand where would they have borrowed their idea of the apocalypse. Well, they borrowed it straight out of the biblical text. They borrowed it straight out of the Jewish traditions. Not only have you got the Safa and Marwa correct, which is what you have introduced before, so has Paul introduced, but looking at the Kidron Valley, and that is where the apocalypse is going to have, which is still there. That Kidron Valley is still there. And the Valley of Gehenna, that's where hell is, according to Islam. But that's where the last judgment is going to happen. And you can see all these references are there in the Quran, pointing to Jerusalem. And as you said at the very end, also where the Dajjal is going to be destroyed. The Dajjal would be what we would know as the Antichrist. They're equivalent to the Antichrist. That is going to happen in Tel Aviv. Notice those are both in what is Israel today, 1,000 miles further north. Nothing is new under the sun. They've just borrowed and they have taken it. Even some of the names are the same with the Arabic distortions. Instead of Mariah, it's Marwa. Instead of Scopus, it is Safa, which is the same pronunciation that Josephus used in the end of the first century, the beginning of the second century.
Do you know, Jay, I want to say here that if you ask most Muslims what is the number one argument that makes them believe in Islam, it's all of this stuff to do with the apocalypse. That's the killer argument. But what they don't seem to realize is where it all comes from.
There you
It's all
go.
coming from, it all come from Jerusalem.
Now, for those Muslims who are watching and also those Christians who are watching, can you understand that we need to not now start discussing this? If it is that important for Muslims that they're concerned about the apocalypse, as Mel is saying, and that is true, you will see that they are deeply concerned about the apocalypse. They're deeply concerned about the end times. Help them understand that this makes no sense in Mecca at all. None of this makes sense in Mecca. It only makes sense in Jerusalem. Folks, if it only makes sense in Jerusalem, if this is where it is actually derived from, then why don't you go back to the original? Why don't you go back to Jerusalem? Why don't you go back to where the Bible talks about it? Why aren't you ready for it? Because if you really are concerned for it, then you better not take the alternative. You better not take the artificial view. Because listen, the Quran is nothing more than, and so are the traditions, are nothing more than borrowings. Why don't you go back to the original? Come back to the real text. Why don't you come back to the real reference point? And this is it right here. All of this that we're talking about, everything that Mel has brought up, does not come from tradition. It comes from the Bible itself. Folks, this guy doesn't even have it. This book doesn't even understand it. And that's why the traditions have to be written. Do you notice the traditions are written in the 9th and 10th century to try to understand the tafsir? They're known as the tafsir. Because this book was so confusing, because so many Muslims did not understand, they had to create the whole tafsir, starting with Al-Tabari, Zamakhshari, Suyuti, Maldu, all these who come after the 10th century, after 923, trying to make sense of it. But what they made sense is almost everything that they put into these traditions, in the hadith, also in the sirah, also in the tafsir, in the tariq, are all predicated on this book and predicated on the city that this book is talking about, where there is going to be an apocalypse, where Magog and Gog are going to be found, and where also the Eastern Gate is. Where do you think all these places are? They're not in Mecca. They're way up 1,000 miles further north in Jerusalem. Mel, this has been terrific. Thanks for helping us out on this. And thanks for
I've
really.
got one more point.
Go ahead. One last point.
Yeah, this is a really important point, actually. If you ask Muslims where are the three holiest places in this world, they would say Mecca, they would say Yathrib, Medina, and then they would say Jerusalem.
There you go.
Why has Muhammad ascended into heaven from the third holiest place if that's true? That doesn't make sense.
Bingo.
So that suggests that originally the story was different. That's what I'm going to argue.
And as we said many times before, if it was that, if that's where he went to the seven heavens, why is nothing written about it on the very building that commemorates that event? That building was never built to commemorate that event. That building was there built for lots of other reasons, nothing to do with the Mi'raj, as it's known. It's all to do with attacking Jesus Christ. Bingo. Okay. God bless you. Thanks so much, Mel. This has been fun.